that building, the Manchester Community Library. And tonight is our last first Wednesday of the year. And I'm going to go off script a little, and I'm going to start by some thank yous. And the first thank you is to our audience. We have seen you, and some of you may be new, but this place has been filled on some of the coldest, meanest Vermont nights than anybody remembers. And one of the things that happens is that we are the leader in the state of Vermont on First Wednesdays. The results are not in for the 2014-2015 season, but we are really rocking it. And it's because of all of you coming out and, you know, participating and joining and learning and having a great evening. The second place I want to start with some thank yous is, first of all, the people who make this happen for all of us. And from the Manchester Community Library, I want her to stand up, Cindy Waters. Where are you, Cindy? Cindy is the woman that makes this happen. And she makes it happen seamlessly, and she does it with a smile. And she is our adult coordinator at the library. So all those wonderful adult programs that we're doing, thank you, Cindy. The other person who is not here tonight is Allie, Allie White, who is the person who coordinates the programs for the Vermont Humanities Council. And Allie is the person who knows everybody. She knows what programs would work in this community. She learns about this community. She figures out what you guys like, and she makes those people come here. And I will tell you that when you sit at a table with Allie, because of you guys coming out, Allie makes sure that we get the best of the best here. It's a self-fulfilling prophecy. If you come, it gets better. So thank you. And now I'll go a little scripty. One other place that I want to thank. As a member of the board, this used to be a line item on our operating budget, and if anybody's ever been on a board with an operating budget, you really like to get rid of line items. And the people who've made that happen for us, because we have to pay for First Wednesdays. It's partially supported by the Vermont Humanities Council, and it's partially supported by the library. And we need to really thank and support our local businesses. The Perfect Wife Restaurant and Tavern, go eat there, it's great food. The Spiral Press Cafe, can't miss at the North Shore Bookstore with a cup of coffee. And Vermont Renewable Fuels for sponsoring First Wednesdays for us. It makes it free for all of you. And also thank you to Max Maxson, I love that, and Jimmy Woodard, the famous Jimmy, for producing, you know, bringing all the technology in here so that we can now hear people when they're speaking. So now I'll go on script here. You can keep your First Wednesday's habit alive by attending Summer Wednesdays. This is sponsored by the library, and Cindy's got some really cool stuff happening. And those will be all held at the library. Please refer to the flyer in your pew for the upcoming schedule. A sign-in sheet is being passed around. Please sign it if you would like to receive emails about upcoming events. After this evening's lecture, please take a moment to fill out the feedback form that is on the piano to my left. The Humanities Council welcomes your ideas and suggestions about the First Wednesdays series. And now, I would like to introduce this evening's speaker who will discuss Redeemer President, the significance of Jimmy Carter. Randall Balmer is the Dartmouth Professor of Arts and Sciences and Chair of the Religion Department at Dartmouth College. Before coming to Dartmouth, he was Professor of American Religious History at Columbia University for 27 years. He has been a visiting professor at Princeton, Yale, Northwestern and Emory Universities, and in the Columbia University Graduate School of Journalism. He was a visiting professor at Yale Divinity School from 2004 to 2008. He earned his PhD from Princeton University in 1985. Balmer, an Episcopal priest, is an author of a dozen books, including God in the White House, We could use some of that. How Faith Shaped the Presidency from John F. Kennedy to George Bush. His second book, Mine Eyes Have Seen the Glory, A Journey into the Evangelical Subculture in America, now in its fourth edition, was made into an award-winning three-part documentary for PBS. Professor Balmer was nominated for an Emmy for writing and hosting that series. His newest book is Redeemer, The Life of Jimmy Carter. Copies of the book will be for sale following tonight's presentation. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming. Am I on here? Okay. No? No? How about this? Can you hear me now? Hello? All right. I'm delighted to be here. I feel like Manchester is kind of my second home here in Vermont. My wife and I fill in occasionally for Zion Episcopal Church and St. John's Chapel. In fact, I think we're scheduled for third Sunday in June to be back, so we'll be back in Manchester again. And you're right, this is the largest crowd. I moved here to Vermont 3 years ago. I've done St. Johnsbury and Middlebury. You've got them all beat, so congratulations. I'm here to talk tonight about this stunning new book called Redeemer, The Life of Jimmy Carter. And let me tell you a little bit about how I came to write this book. I grew up as an evangelical. Let me just take a minute to define that term. I'm going to take my jacket off if I can. It's a little bit warm here. I use a three-part definition to define an evangelical. An evangelical is somebody who takes the Bible very seriously as God's revelation to humanity. So you would have evangelicals who at least claim to interpret the Bible literally, although, as I've noted many times, many evangelicals, or most evangelicals, engage in what I call the ruse of selective literalism when they come to the Bible, but we all do that. Anybody who reads the Bible and who takes the Bible seriously reads it selectively. Secondly, on the basis of that cornerstone of the Bible as God's revelation to humanity, evangelicals believe in the centrality of a conversion or a born-again experience. And the term born-again comes from the third chapter of St. John in the New Testament, when Nicodemus, a Jewish leader, visits Jesus by night and asks Jesus, how can I go to the kingdom of heaven? How can I be admitted into the kingdom of heaven? And Jesus replies in the King James Version, you must be born again. Other versions have born from above. But this is where the term born again comes from, in the third chapter of St. John in the New Testament. And evangelicals speak of this as a transformative moment. Most evangelicals will be able to say, I was born again, or I was converted, or I was saved, these are all synonymous terms, on June 17th, 1983. I was in the hospital getting ready to go down to surgery, and my roommate in the hospital read to me from the Bible, and I accepted Jesus into my heart, or I became saved or born again. And this is a transformative moment. And very often, as I said, a dateable moment. And the third general characteristic of an evangelical is somebody who takes seriously what evangelicals call the Great Commission. At the end of the Gospel of Mark in the New Testament, Jesus enjoins his followers to go into all the world and preach the gospel, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Evangelicals will accordingly then try to bring others into the faith or proselytize others into the faith. Having said that, I also want to add that it's been my observation over the last 50 years or so that evangelicals talk about doing this a great deal more than they actually do it. They tend to hire professionals to do it for them. Missionaries, visitation ministers, and other people who do that. But nevertheless, an evangelical will most likely say that she or he has an obligation to spread the word and spread the gospel. Well, this is the tradition in which I was reared, and it's the tradition in which Jimmy Carter was reared. So that was my connection initially with Jimmy Carter. Jimmy Carter began to burst onto the national scene in the early 1970s. I was at that time an undergraduate in an evangelical college in Deerfield, Illinois, and he was talking my language. He was saying that he was a born-again Christian, and most important for me and for many others of my cohort, he didn't seem ashamed about it. We were always kind of cowering in the background, kind of afraid to talk about our faith because we were afraid of public ridicule and so forth. But Jimmy Carter came along and said, "Yes, I'm a born-again Christian. I have had a conversion experience. I take the Bible very seriously. Jesus is my Lord and Savior," and so forth. And so I began to take notice and to pay attention to the career of Jimmy Carter as it began to take off in the early 1970s. And so over the years, I have, for many years, probably too many years, entertained the idea that someday I would write a biography of Jimmy Carter, one that took his faith seriously as a way of understanding him and the way he approached the world and certainly even his presidency. Just to talk a little bit about Jimmy Carter and his background, Jimmy Carter was born on October 1st, 1924 in Plains, Georgia. He was the first American president to be born in a hospital. His mother, Lillian Carter, who I'm sure many of you remember from the 1976 campaign as Miss Lillian, as she was known, was a kind of itinerant nurse in Plains, Georgia, and so she had access to hospital facilities, and most women in that area in southwestern Georgia did not. And so that's why Jimmy Carter is the first American president born in a hospital. October 1st, 1924 means that he just turned 90 years old this past fall. He's still doing well, still going strong, as you probably see from time to time in the newspapers. And if you want a bit of trivia, I think I'm probably the only person who knows this. I just happen to notice these dates. Jimmy Carter was born on the same day that William Rehnquist was born, the Supreme Court Justice. You can probably win a beer with that information sometime if you'd like. I give it to you free of charge. A bit of trivia. The Carter family lived his first 3 years in Plains, and then they moved, when he was 3 years old, about 3 miles down the road to Archery, Georgia. I'm wondering if anybody's ever been to the Jimmy Carter historical site down in... Okay, a few of you have. Okay, good. All right. Correct me if I'm wrong, but my guess is that you came away fairly impressed with the modesty of Jimmy Carter's origins. He has never complained about growing up poor. In fact, he's often made the case that he and his family were more prosperous than most of their neighbors. But if you visit the farmstead in Archery, Georgia, there's nothing lavish about it. In fact, Jimmy Carter was 14 years old before they had plumbing and indoor toilets in that farm place in Archery, Georgia. Jimmy Carter went to the Plains public schools. He often went barefoot, walked to school. He was very conscious of himself as a country boy and wanted to kind of dispel that image. But he applied himself. He studied very hard. There were a number of teachers that he has over the years credited with his educational development, particularly a woman by the name of Julia Coleman, who spent her summers at the Chautauqua Institution up in upstate New York, near Jamestown, New York. And one summer came back to Plains after her time at Chautauqua and decided to start a book club in Plains, no doubt modeled on the Chautauqua Literary and Scientific Society, something like that. It claims to be the oldest book club in the country. And she challenged her student, young Jimmy Carter, to read War and Peace, all 1,200 pages of War and Peace. Jimmy Carter, thinking it was a book about cowboys and Indians, dove in and indeed read War and Peace. Jimmy Carter tends to finish whatever he starts, if he possibly can, and that's what he did in that instance. Julie Coleman also said in the classroom that, who knows, maybe somebody here could be president of the United States someday. And young Jimmy Carter was listening as she said that. After he graduated from Plains High School, he spent a couple of years waiting for a commission to the U.S. Naval Academy in Annapolis, something he'd wanted to do since he was a very small boy, and was finally admitted and went off to Annapolis. And this is where he begins teaching Sunday school. He teaches Sunday school to the daughters, to the the high school girls or junior high school girls who were the daughters of the officers in the academy at in Annapolis. Something that he continues to do to this day. I'll come back to Jimmy Carter and Sunday school in a little while. 1953 is a very important date in the life of Jimmy Carter because he receives news when he and Rosalynn are stationed up in Schenectady, New York, that his father, Earl Carter, was dying of pancreatic cancer at the age of 53. And I'm going to insert this here. If anyone needs further evidence that smoking is not good for your health, all three of Jimmy Carter's siblings died of pancreatic cancer. Both his parents died of pancreatic cancer. All of them were smokers. Jimmy Carter has never smoked. Except for once, just tried it. So I'll just throw that out there. You can do with what you want with that information. Carter was given leave to return to Plains to attend his father's bedside, and he was powerfully impressed by the stream of people who came to Mr. Earl's bedside to pay their respects as he lay dying there in the Plains Hospital. And what he found out for the first time, what Jimmy Carter found out for the first time, was that his father had engaged in various discreet acts of kindness and generosity to people within the community. The time when a family wanted to attend their daughter's graduation, but it didn't have good clothes to do that, and they wanted to be able to do so with pride. And so he bought new clothes for the family so they could attend this important event in their lives and do so with dignity. The time that he carried the mortgage for another family who was facing straitened financial circumstances. And also many, many times when he had extended credit from his store and his feed store in particular to people who were needy and couldn't afford to pay over the counter. And Jimmy Carter heard about this for the first time. He didn't know this about his father. But he was powerfully impressed by this. And he decided, after Mr. Earl, his father, died, that he was going to return to Plains and try to have the same kind of life and influence that his father, Earl Carter, had had in that community. Rosalynn Carter was not amused. She liked being a Navy wife. She liked the adventure. They had lived in various places, including Hawaii. And she thought that she wanted to continue this kind of life. And so when Jimmy came back to Schenectady and announced that they were moving back to Plains, the term divorce cropped up in their conversations quite a bit during this time. And apparently the car trip from Schenectady, New York, all the way down to southwestern Georgia transpired in almost total silence between these two very strong-willed individuals. The marriage between Jimmy Carter and Rosalynn Smith had been a mixed marriage in Plains because Jimmy Carter was Southern Baptist and, of course, Rosalynn Smith was a Methodist, so they had to work that out. But that was one of the many things they had to work out over the course of their marriage, and it is, in fact, a very companionate and happy marriage by all accounts. Jimmy Carter took over the Carter Warehouse, the business interests of the family there. The first year they turned a profit of only $200, but again he applied himself, he learned, he read whatever he could about agriculture and about storekeeping and so forth, and Rosalynn began to keep the books, and pretty soon the Carter Warehouse was turning a profit and making Jimmy Carter one of the major businessmen in the small town of Plains. On October 1st, 1962, Jimmy Carter's 38th birthday, he got out of bed, put on his church trousers rather than his workaday trousers, and announced to Rosalynn that he was heading to Americus to file papers to run for the Georgia State Senate. This was the first that Rosalynn had heard about this. And when I asked Carter about it, he actually got flushed and he was embarrassed. He's like, I can't believe I actually did that, that I would do something that momentous without having consulted Rosalynn beforehand. But nevertheless, he did so, and Rosalind got into the swing of things, and even though she was very, very painfully shy, she would make phone calls on Jimmy's behalf. She even designed some campaign literature. Whenever Jimmy Carter could afford a few hours away from the store, from the business interests, he would go out and try to meet voters within this Senate district, Georgia Senate district in southwestern Georgia. The Democratic primary came along, and the political boss of Quitman County, a cigar-chomping politician by the name of Joe Hurst, Sheriff Joe Hurst, decided that somebody else other than Jimmy Carter should be the Democratic nominee for the Georgia State Senate. And on election day in Quitman County, he engineered an extraordinary get-out-of-the-vote effort there in Quitman County. Out of something like 330 registered voters, don't hold me to these numbers, over 400 turned out to vote for Jimmy Carter's opponent, Herman Moore, in that primary election. And even what was even more remarkable, you won't believe this, they even managed, most of them, to vote in alphabetical order, down to the second and third letters of their last names. It was remarkable. Jimmy Carter hears about this during election days, about midway through the day. He goes to Quitman County, he sees what's happening, and he just seethes. He writes about this campaign in his book called Turning Point, which is my favorite of his books, actually, because you can just, the moral indignation is palpable. He just can't believe that this is happening. Here he had trusted the political system, and the political system had betrayed him, and he was going to make good on that election, and he did. He was able to do so with the help of a journalist from the Atlanta newspapers and other legal maneuverings. And finally, in January of 1963, he takes the oath of office as Georgia State Senator. He decides almost immediately to run for governor of Georgia, which he does in 1966. Once again, he throws himself into this campaign, investing a lot of the family money, also losing 22 pounds in the course of the campaign just because he was working so hard trying to meet voters around the state. And then on election day, it turns out he loses to, of all people, and many of you will recognize this name, Lester G. Maddox, arch segregationist who becomes governor of Georgia over Jimmy Carter. This is devastating to Jimmy Carter. Jimmy Carter had run as a racial moderate in the 1966 campaign. Lester Maddox ran as a segregationist. Some of you may remember the story. On the day after Lyndon Johnson signed the Civil Rights Act of 1964, Lester G. Maddox, who had a restaurant called the Pickrick Restaurant in Atlanta, Georgia, went out to the parking lot to intercept three African-American young men who were coming to eat in his restaurant because it was a segregated restaurant and he meant to keep it as a segregated restaurant. And he met them with an axe handle. And these axe handles became symbolic of his campaign. He sold these axe handles for $2 a piece to patrons at the Pickrick restaurant. And on the basis of that little political stunt, Lester Maddox rides that wave to the governorship of Georgia in 1966. Jimmy Carter returns back to Plains utterly disconsolate. Friends and family talk about him at that point walking through fields and plains and around the homestead and so forth. Just a defeated man, very often in tears, trying to figure out what had happened. Why would God allow a segregationist like Lester Maddox to become governor of Georgia over somebody like Jimmy Carter? And this is when he has a very important religious experience. Like most evangelicals, and I defined it for you earlier, Jimmy Carter at the age of 11 in 1935 had a born-again experience, had a conversion moment, and was baptized into the Plains Baptist Church. But after the 1966 gubernatorial campaign, which he lost, he begins to have a moment of self-searching. And he's helped in that moment by another woman you'll probably remember, his sister, Ruth Carter Stapleton, who was a Pentecostal evangelist. And she came back to Plains, and she and Jimmy had long conversations, and Jimmy Carter resolves to live more fully for Jesus, to live more fully as a Christian in the wake of that electoral loss in 1966. That same year, which 1967 was when he had the experience, that same year he embarks on a mission trip with other Southern Baptist laymen to Lock Haven, Pennsylvania, where they go around literally knocking on doors to tell people about Jesus. First time I met Carter was at an event at Emory University, a small meeting before the event at Emory University. This was roughly 2006. And what he wanted to talk about in that small gathering was what he called the unsurpassed joy of telling others about Christ. That was so important to him. Later that same year, after going to Lock Haven, Pennsylvania, he spends another week in Springfield, Massachusetts. And there he's paired with a Puerto Rican minister, a man by the name of Eloy Cruz. And they go around Springfield, Massachusetts into many of the Spanish-speaking neighborhoods. And Carter, with his at least rudimentary command of Spanish, would read from the Bible. And then Eloy Cruz, the minister, the pastor, would talk to the family or preach to the family and invite them to accept Jesus into their hearts. And he was so effective that Carter, at the end of the week, asked Cruz, "Why is it that you are so effective as a preacher? Why is it you are so winsome to people when you talk about Christ?" And Cruz was very shy, very diffident. He didn't want to answer Carter's question because he thought Carter was superior to him. And finally, after Carter pressed him, he finally said, "Senior Jimmy, the key to a life of faith is to have two loves in your life, one for God and the other for whatever individual is standing in front of you at any given time." And Carter has quoted this again and again and again as an important lesson for understanding his faith and his Christian faith more particularly. He goes back to Plains and then decides once again to run for governor of Georgia in 1970, 4 years after the first campaign that did not work out so well. And this is a campaign that's not terribly pretty. The Carter Center, the Carter Library, doesn't have much material on the 1970 campaign for governor, because Carter actually courts some of the segregationist votes toward the end of that campaign. He was so eager to be victorious in that campaign that he solicits and gets the endorsement of some of the segregationist leaders in Georgia. He feels remorseful about this almost immediately. But, and we could probably have a long conversation about means and ends, right? What sort of means do you to do to get to a certain end? But Carter did it. He was elected governor of Georgia. And almost immediately he repents. When he gives his inaugural address on January 12, 1971, he announces memorably that in Georgia, the time for racial segregation is over. This is picked up the next day in the New York Times on the first page above the fold in an article about Jimmy Carter as a so-called New South governor. Jimmy Carter then, several weeks later, appears on the cover of Time magazine, again, as an example of a New South governor, together with Reuben Askew of Florida and Dale Bumpers of Arkansas. And almost immediately, Jimmy Carter begins to think about running for president of the United States. He's an ambitious man. One of the reasons he's often said that he decided to run for president is that once he was governor, a lot of the Democratic aspirants for the presidential nomination in 1976 started to stop by the governor's mansion. And Carter was underwhelmed by all of them. And he figured, if they can run for president, I can run for president. And so he begins to do that. This is really quite a remarkable enterprise for a one-term, not even yet a one-term governor of Georgia, to think about running for president of the United States. At the same time, I'm going to diverge from Carter here in just a moment, just for a minute, and talk about what's happening within evangelicalism at this time. Ever since the Scopes trial of 1925, evangelicals had largely been shy of politics, have not been involved, certainly not in any organized way, in the political arena. But what happens in the early 1970s, about the time that Jimmy Carter is thinking of running for president, is that there's a remarkable resurgence of progressive evangelicalism. I'm sure when you think of evangelical today, you think of the religious right, people like Jerry Falwell and James Dobson and Chuck Colson, and all of whom are, well, Dobson's retired, the other two are deceased, but you think about Tony Perkins or whoever might come to mind. But in the early 1970s, a group of progressive evangelicals were making a case for a faith that was politically active, but politically active toward the left of the political spectrum. These are people like, still around today, people like Tony Campolo, some of you may have heard that name. Probably more of you have heard of Jim Wallace in the Sojourners magazine out of Washington, D.C. Ronald Sider, a seminary professor out of Philadelphia. Richard Mao, probably not heard of that name, but there were a remarkable group of progressive evangelicals. And they met in Chicago, on the south side of Chicago, at the YMCA over Thanksgiving weekend in 1973, and produced a document called the Chicago Declaration of Evangelical Social Concern. And I invite you to look at it for yourself. It's on the web. You can find it. Just do a Google search, and you can find the Chicago Declaration of Evangelical Social Concern. What was remarkable about this document was that it was trying to recover many of the principles and political positions of 19th century evangelicals, particularly antebellum evangelicals, who had been very concerned about the issue of slavery, as you might imagine, but also issues like public education. They were very much in support of common schools, as they were known in the 19th century, as a way for those in the lower rungs of society to become upwardly mobile. They were concerned about temperance. Temperance was a huge issue in the early part of the 19th century. We think of temperance today as a kind of paternalistic, overweening movement. But in the 19th century, the temperance movement addressed some very, very real social ills in American society caused by a huge overconsumption of alcohol. And with that, of course, you had the problems of child abuse, spousal abuse, and so forth. And evangelicals were active in that. Evangelicals were active in prison reform, the whole idea of a penitentiary, a place where a criminal could go not merely to be segregated from society, but to become penitent so that he might or she might be able to rejoin society in a constructive way at some point in the future. Finally, evangelicals in the antebellum period were concerned about equality for women, including voting rights, which was a very radical issue in the antebellum period, but evangelicals were very much behind that. And what the Chicago Declaration of Evangelical Social Concern states in 1973 is that we want to be identified with this noble legacy of 19th century evangelical political activism that invariably took the part of those on the margins of society. They, for example, talked about the persistence of hunger in a society of such affluence. They talked about the scourge of poverty. They talked about persistent racism in American society, decried the militarism in American society. This, of course, was right at the end of the Vietnam War, so that was an issue very much on the minds of many, many people in American society. And they also reaffirmed the notion of equality for women. So this Chicago Declaration suggests that in the early 1970s, there was a kind of recrudescence of evangelical progressivism. And part of what I argue in this remarkable book, by the way, is that Jimmy Carter's campaign for the presidency is aided by this surge of evangelical progressivism. Now, I'm not going to try to argue, and please don't get me wrong. Evangelical progressives did not put Jimmy Carter in the White House, not by any stretch of the imagination. They weren't strong enough to do that. They weren't large enough to do that. But Carter's campaign in the mid-1970s picks up on many of those same principles in the early part of the 1970s. In fact, Less than 6 months after the Chicago Declaration of Evangelical Social Concern, there was an event that took place in Athens, Georgia, in May of 1974, called Law Day. This was a long tradition at the University of Georgia Law School for the graduating class to invite distinguished visitors, guests, to come in and address them to celebrate their graduation from law school. And so over the years, Supreme Court justices, national politicians, attorneys general have all come to Athens, Georgia for Law Day. And in 1974, the keynote speaker was the senior senator from Massachusetts, Edward Moore Kennedy, who talked about the impending impeachment proceedings that were moving through the House of Representatives to impeach Richard Nixon, which would occur within a few months of that Law Day address. The next speaker on the schedule, the undercard speaker, was the governor of Georgia. And Jimmy Carter goes down to Athens, Georgia, and he starts talking over lunch amid the clatter of dishes and so forth, and he starts talking about his understanding of justice, where his understanding of justice came from. And he credited two theologians. The first was Reinhold Niebuhr, who famously said that the sad duty of politics was to establish justice in a sinful world. The second theologian he credited for his understanding of justice was the venerable theologian Bob Dylan. Particularly Bob Dylan's song, "Ain't Gonna Work on Maggie's Farm No More," which talks about the plight of tenant farmers. And Carter went on to talk about various injustices in American society, noting, for example, that the preponderance of the prison population in Georgia were people of color, people who could not afford adequate legal representation, and talked about what he was trying to do to redress that problem among the people in Georgia. He also talked about the cozy relationship between regulators and the regulated in Washington, and he decried that, saying that this is not appropriate, this is unjust. Midway through his remarks, Carter noticed one of the journalists in attendance slipped out for a few minutes and then came back, and he initially thought that Hunter S. Thompson of Rolling Stone magazine was going out simply to refresh whatever adult beverage he was consuming that day, but it turned out, as Hunter Thompson reaffirmed many, many times afterwards, he was going to his car to retrieve his tape recorder because he wanted to record something extraordinary, a politician willing to tell the truth and willing to speak out to powerful interests. And that is in part what propels Jimmy Carter toward the presidency as well in 1974. He announces a candidacy for the Democratic nomination on December 12, 1974, first at the National Press Club in Washington, and then he flies down to Atlanta for a rally and says that he's running for president. And he takes that message, of course, to the precincts of Iowa and to the small towns of New Hampshire. We were talking earlier about Jimmy Carter as a retail politician, and people who remember him from that campaign, particularly in Iowa and North Carolina, talk about him as an extraordinary retail politician. Jimmy Carter's not much of a speech maker. He's not an orator. Eugene McCarthy, some of you remember that name. Eugene McCarthy once characterized him as a rhetorical mortician. But one-on-one, Carter was very effective in presenting his case for the Democratic presidential nomination. In the spring of 1976, then he begins to work through the primaries. He finishes first in Iowa on January 19th, 1976, moves on to New Hampshire, does well in New Hampshire, and then in March of 1976, and I think this is something that Carter doesn't get credit for nearly enough, Jimmy Carter effectively ended the political career of the nation's most notorious segregationist by beating George C. Wallace in the Florida primary on March 6, 1976. I don't think Jimmy Carter gets enough credit for doing that, but Carter did that. He effectively ended George Wallace's political career in the spring of 1976. He moves on to the Democratic nomination, is sailing toward a landslide victory, and then on September 20th, 1976, the newsstands carry an interview in Playboy magazine. Remember this? Some of you remember this? That just was a terrible mistake for Jimmy Carter politically. This is the interview where he said, memorably, that he had lusted after women other than his own wife, and the media were, I don't know, I can't, what's the word? They went ballistic over this comment. Now, for evangelicals, it's an utterly unremarkable comment, right? What did Jesus say in the Sermon on the Mount? You've heard that the law says you shall not kill your brother. I tell you, if you hate your brother, it's as good as if you've killed him. The law says you shall not commit adultery. But if you look on a woman with lust, you have committed adultery in your heart. It's almost verbatim what Carter had said in the interview. But the media just went crazy with this. Their editorial cartoons, and one of them saw was Jimmy Carter looking at the Statue of Liberty in a state of undress. It was utter silliness. But it was catastrophic for him politically. He dropped 15 percentage points in the polls after the Playboy interview and barely eked out a victory over Gerald Ford in the 1976 presidential election. Jimmy Carter takes office on January 20th, 1977, and his first official act is to pardon Vietnam-era draft resistors as a way of trying to put in the past one of the most divisive chapters in American history. He also proceeds to work on his foreign and domestic policy platform proposals, including a recognition on his part that if the United States was to have any meaningful relationship with third world countries, and particularly with Latin America, we had to renegotiate the Panama Canal treaties. And he expended a great deal of political capital early in his presidency on securing the ratification of the Panama Canal treaties. He also sought to move American foreign policy away from the reflexive Cold War dualism of the post-war period toward an emphasis on human rights. And his policies on human rights, even though it angered many of our allies, nevertheless succeeded in freeing a good number of political prisoners, both during his administration and beyond that. And even today, the language of human rights is part of the discourse of diplomacy in this country and around the world, primarily because of Jimmy Carter. Jimmy Carter also faced a very, very difficult time with the economy. He inherited a bad economy, did not get appreciably better during his presidency. Arguably, it got worse, even though he was able to add 8 million jobs in the course of his administration. Part of the social context that negated that was that many women in the late 1970s were entering the workforce for the first time. And so even though 8 million new jobs were added in the late 1970s, it really didn't have much of an effect on middle-class families. Of course, you had the energy crisis, which Jimmy Carter framed in moral terms. He talked about the moral equivalent of war. People who study energy policy, including a friend of mine who spent his whole life doing so, says that if we had followed Jimmy Carter's prescriptions on energy in the late 1970s, we would be in a far different place today in terms of our energy dependence on other sources around the world. One of the things that happens during Jimmy Carter's presidency, and this is part of, how long do I have here?
10:45.
All right, when do you want me to quit? Just keep going, okay, all right. One of the things that happens during Jimmy Carter's presidency, and it's really this is kind of the central question that I sought to address in this book, is why it was that evangelicals who had helped to elect Jimmy Carter in 1976 turned so dramatically against him 4 years later. Well, the standard answer is that they were unhappy with Jimmy Carter on the abortion issue because they had been all revved up about abortion ever since the Roe v. Wade decision of 1973. And again, as I mentioned earlier, I was living in that world quite, you know, almost in the center of that world in the 1970s, for most of the 1970s, and I knew that that was not really the case, that that abortion just wasn't an issue that engaged evangelicals in the 1970s. And I've come to call this the abortion myth. And it's a myth that has been propagated by Falwell, Robertson, many other leaders of the religious right, who kept saying the reason we got involved and organized politically was because of our moral outrage over the Roe v. Wade decision of January 1973. They went so far as to characterize themselves as the so-called new abolitionists, trying to equate their opposition to abortion to the opposition of antebellum evangelicals to the scourge of slavery. It's a great story, and it's also utter fiction. I call it the abortion myth. So, what brought them into the political arena? Well, again, this is one of the reasons I wanted to write this book, to be able to figure out the story for myself. Turns out that what really got them into the political arena was a court decision. It was not Roe v. Wade. It was a lower court decision, District Court, District of Columbia, handed down on June 30th, 1971, in a case called Green v. Connolly. Now, let me give you a little bit of background. There was an important court case, as probably the most important court case in American history, or at least in the 20th century, was the Brown v. Board of Education ruling of 1954 that demanded, or mandated rather, the desegregation of public schools. Well, as we all know, one of the strategies that many communities, particularly in the South, but not entirely, used to countermand the Brown v. Board of Education ruling was to set up what became known as segregation academies, right? Many of them sponsored by churches, private schools, so that white parents could send their students to all white schools and not into the integrated public schools. Well, down in Holmes County, Mississippi, in the 1960s, what was happening was that the white population in the public schools was dropping dramatically. The first year of desegregation, don't quote me on these figures, but it's roughly like this. This first year of desegregation in Holmes County, Mississippi, the number of white students dropped from 740 to 28. The second year of desegregation, the number of white students in the public schools dropped to zero. At the same time, several segregation academies were being formed, and they were applying to the IRS for tax-exempt status. And several families in Holmes County, Mississippi, brought a court case against these segregation academies. And this case made its way through the courts up to the District Court, District of Columbia. And on June 30th, 1971, the court said, in effect, any organization that engages in racial segregation or racial discrimination is not, by definition, a charitable organization. Therefore, it has no claims on tax-exempt status. After that ruling, Richard Nixon, president at the time, instructed the IRS not to issue any more tax exemptions to segregated schools. The IRS then sends out a questionnaire to schools that they suspect, might be engaging in racial segregation. One of those letters, one of those questionnaires, falls on the desk of Bob Jones Jr., president of Bob Jones University in Greenville, South Carolina. And Bob Jones Jr. replies, in effect, yes, we segregate, and we're proud of it, thereby ensuring that the IRS is going to follow up. Well, what happens then is that the IRS, after a series of warnings, finally rescinds the tax exemption of Bob Jones University, a fundamentalist school in Greenville, South Carolina, on January 19th, 1976. That date's important. This is what gets the attention of people like Jerry Falwell, who has his own segregation academy in Lynchburg, Virginia. And they get in a lather over the federal government and the IRS, and they organize politically in response to the Green v. Connolly decision of 1971. How did abortion become part of this? Being a historian is great fun. It's like an adventure. As I was researching the book, I learned that Paul Weyrich, remember this name, Paul Weyrich? Paul Weyrich is really the architect of the religious right, a conservative activist who died, I don't know, 4 or 5, maybe 6 years ago now. He's really the genius behind the religious right. And Weyrich, I had a conversation with Weyrich myself back in 1990, where I said, abortion wasn't the issue, right? And he said, no, it's not the abortion issue. What got us involved politically was the school issue and the IRS. So he was emphatic about that. So I knew that about Weyrich. I found out his papers are in, of all places, the University of Wyoming in Laramie, Wyoming. Now, don't ask me why, but that's where they are. So I went out there trying to figure out this whole question. And I got to the 1978 midterm elections and went through Weyrich's correspondence. And in that election, there were three Senate seats at stake, actually four. One here in New Hampshire, where's New Hampshire? Over here, I guess. One in New Hampshire with Thomas McIntyre running for re-election, and three in the Midwest. One in Iowa when Dick Clark, not that Dick Clark, but another Dick Clark, a Democratic senator, was running for re-election, and two Senate races in Minnesota, one of them for the unexpired term of Hubert Humphrey. In all four of those races, on the final weekend of the campaign, pro-life activists, Roman Catholics, leafleted church parking lots. And 2 days later, in an election with a very low turnout, all four of those Democratic candidates lost to pro-life Republican candidates for Senate. When I came across that election in Paul Weyrich's papers, it's like the papers were sizzling with excitement. He had finally found the issue that was going to galvanize grassroots evangelicals. He'd already had them on his side, the leaders on his side, on the Bob Jones case, but this is what got grassroots evangelicals interested in abortion. Several weeks later, there's a film series that begins to tour the country that features two individuals, one by the name of Francis Schaeffer, who's kind of the intellectual godfather of evangelicalism and the religious right in the late 70s, and the other person featured in that film series was a pediatric surgeon from Philadelphia named C. Everett Koop. In a film series called Whatever Happened to the Human Race. And what Schaeffer and Koop argue in that film series is that any society that countenances abortion will very quickly also tolerate infanticide and euthanasia. And all of this is secular humanism. Remember that term? Secular humanism. This is what gets these evangelicals to turn against Jimmy Carter in favor of Ronald Reagan in 1980. One of the things that they kept talking about in that campaign was Jimmy Carter's IRS and its persecution of our schools. Thinking about the Bob Jones case, I mentioned the date was important. January 19th, 1976 was the day that Bob Jones University lost its tax-exempt status. It's also the day that Jimmy Carter won the Iowa precinct caucuses on his way to the Democratic nomination for president. He didn't take office until a year and a day later, after Bob Jones University lost its tax-exempt status, and yet Paul Weyrich and Ronald Reagan blamed Jimmy Carter for the IRS action against Bob Jones University. Don't get me started. Okay. All right. 1980 election rolls around, and Jimmy Carter, of course, is not doing well. The Iranian hostages, and I think that probably was the most decisive issue in the campaign of 1980. Actually, right toward the end of the campaign, up to the last weekend of the weekend of the campaign, Jimmy Carter and Reagan were running neck and neck. But it turned out that the election day was the same day as the anniversary of the taking of the hostages in Iran. And through that weekend, going up to the election, the media, of course, were talking about the anniversary and the continued captivity of the hostages, and Carter's approval ratings just dropped through the floor in that final weekend of that campaign. And of course, Ronald Reagan was elected president in 1980. One of the reasons I call the book Redeemer is that I think at various times in his life and his career, Jimmy Carter has been redemptive. First for himself, after the tawdry campaign of 1970, he redeemed himself by working for racial desegregation and for better relations for people of color in Georgia, beginning with his declaration during his inauguration address when he became governor in 1971. The second sense of Jimmy Carter as a redeemer is I think he really did redeem the nation from the sins of Watergate and the Nixon administration. I try to impress on students these days how dark this country was during the Nixon years. And it wasn't just Nixon, right? You know, Lyndon Johnson had lied to us about Vietnam. Nixon had lied to us about pretty much everything. And we were in a true constitutional crisis in this country in the final days of the Nixon administration. And I think it's impossible to imagine Jimmy Carter becoming president of the United States had it not been for Richard Nixon, right? The American people were looking for a redemptive figure, somebody outside of Washington. Here comes a Southern Baptist Sunday school teacher, right? You know, with military experience, a veteran. And he comes along, promises never knowingly to lie to the American people. And Jimmy Carter has many faults, and he has even more critics. But no one has seriously accused him of lying to the American people. And bringing integrity to the office of president, I think, was the second sense in which Jimmy Carter was a redeemer. The third sense is that Jimmy Carter, I think, redeemed himself after his devastating loss in 1980 to Ronald Reagan. Jimmy Carter and Rosalynn had always planned to return to Plains after the presidency. No one doubted that they would do so, but they returned 4 years earlier than they wanted to. Rosalynn was angry and embittered. And when I asked Carter about this, and I asked about his response to the 1980 election, he said, well, I rebounded. I had to be strong. I had to keep reassuring Rosalynn that we still had a life ahead of ourselves. We still could do good things in the world, even if we were no longer in Washington. And after a while, I began to believe it, he said. And that's how he was able to redeem himself, I think, through the Carter Center. If you look at the activities of the Carter Center, they're really quite remarkable in terms of mediation of conflict around the world, monitoring of elections, but also in the various health initiatives. The Carter Center has succeeded in eliminating, or all but eliminating, several tropical diseases because of their efforts around the world. Jimmy Carter still speaks out about issues that are important to him. I sometimes refer to him as an equal opportunity nag, because he has criticized all of his successors as presidents, both Republican and Democratic, and he's been unafraid to do so. In fact, I think one of the reasons that Carter has had such a successful post-presidency is that he has been freed from the constraints of elected office or running again for elected office. And one of the things I've argued over the years is that religion or faith always functions best at the margins of society and not in the councils of power. Because once you begin to lust after power and influence, or even proximity, you lose your prophetic voice. And Jimmy Carter, I think, having been defeated in 1980, has been able to exercise his political voice, his prophetic voice, and to do so, I believe, quite effectively. I'd like to close, if I may, if I have a couple more minutes, do I? Oh, here it is. By reading a brief portion from the epilogue to the book, my visit to Plains, Georgia for Jimmy Carter and his Sunday school teaching at Maranatha Baptist Church. Southwest Georgia is Baptist country. The back roads heading south out of Columbus are bracketed by red soil, scruffy pines, and clapboard buildings sporting names like Shiloh Marian Baptist Church, Zion Hill Baptist Church, Piney Grove Missionary Baptist Church, Zion Hill Baptist Church, and Greater Good Hope Baptist Church. Love Jesus no matter what, one roadside sign reads, and another, only Jesus saves. Outside of Preston, Georgia, still another sign implores, take Jesus for your Savior. And the Preston Baptist Church has posted each of the Ten Commandments on a chain link fence for the edification of travelers passing through town. Just before crossing from Webster into Sumter County, signs on Georgia Highway 27 point toward Archery, the boyhood home of Jimmy Carter, and then the road eases into Plains, where it becomes Church Street. The business district, not much more than a block long, lies just beyond the railroad tracks, across the street from the former Seaboard Coast Line Railroad Depot that served as campaign headquarters for Carter's improbable run for the presidency in 1976, and now as a museum commemorating that campaign. Plains, Georgia is no longer the hub of excitement that it was in the summer of 1976, when legions of journalists and thousands of tourists descended to learn more about the Democratic nominee for president. Then, Lillian Carter held court at the train station, and Billy Carter threw back a few beers and entertained visitors with quips like, I've got a mother who joined the Peace Corps and went to India when she was 68. I've got a sister who races motorcycles and another sister who's a holy roller preacher. I've got a brother who says he wants to be president of the United States. Then, pausing for dramatic effect, I'm the only sane one in the family. And I go on and talk about Carter's, sorry about timer, Carter's Sunday school class and so forth. And then after Sunday school and then church, I had a conversation with Carter, and then he wanted to give me a book. And one of the books I didn't have of his, actually. And he said, well, follow me, and I'll give you the book. So I followed his Secret Service caravan, two cars. And we went into the Carter compound, and then he went into the house to get a copy of the book. And Rose and I were talking, and then he comes out, and he says, I couldn't find a new copy, Carter said as he handed me the book. So he had catched Rosalind's copy from the nightstand. I figured I could get you another book, he said with a tentative smile as he glanced in her direction. You're on page 70. Rosalind Carter's bookmark was still in my copy of Through the Year with Jimmy Carter. On page 70, the meditation entitled Patience in Love. I think I'll leave it there. Our time is too... I don't know the procedure here, but I'm happy to take questions if somebody wants to ask. Yes, please.
How much of it was involved with Camp David? How much of it was involved with Camp David? Was it political or how much of it was theological?
That's a great question. The question is about Camp David and how much was political and how much was theological. In this, I don't know if you've read the new book by Lawrence Wright called 13 Days in September about the Camp David Accords. One of the things that struck me in the book was a comment from Walter Mondale, Carter's vice president, who was astonished on Carter's first full day in office when Carter told Mondale, one of my priorities is to bring peace to the Middle East. So I think it was both theological and political. I think he clearly understands the Middle East as the Holy Land, as evangelicals refer to it, and he saw that as one of the important things that he could do to advance peace in the Middle East. And I think most historians since the formation of the State of Israel in 1948 recognize or acknowledge that Carter has done more to advance that cause of peace in the Middle East than anybody anybody else, either his predecessors or certainly his successors. And one of the things he's criticized his successors for, rather insistently, is for failing to advance the Camp David Accords that he had negotiated so painstakingly. So yes, it was very important to him, yes. Please.
How about obligations made after an average? Do you have a certain number of years obligated to the Navy?
Yeah. How long was he in the Navy?
Did he serve out his obligations?
Oh yes, he did. He served out his time as his obligation after being in the Naval Academy. I forgot exactly the number of years, but he actually graduated in 3 years because Roosevelt at that time had an accelerated program for midshipmen at Annapolis to produce more officers for World War II. So Carter finished in 3 years rather than four, along with his classmates. But yeah, he fulfilled his obligations, yes. Please.
One of the things that's always puzzled me about Carter is that as we learn more and more about inequality, income inequality, wealth inequality in the United States, more and more of the historians of this phenomenon say that sometime around 1977 or 78, yeah, things really started getting bad.
Yeah.
And I've wondered to myself, I mean, that's not what Jimmy Carter was philosophically or ideologically,
yeah,
but it happened on his watch, yeah, at least it started on his watch. And I wonder whether you ever had an opportunity to talk to him about that or to understand whether it's just coincidence,
yeah,
or did he have something to do with it?
Yeah, that's a great question. If you didn't hear it, the question had to do with what seems to be a fairly settled issue among economists is that the whole issue of income inequality began to rear itself in the late 1970s during Carter's presidency, during his term in office. And actually, last night, I was at a screening at Dartmouth for the new film Inequality for All with Robert Reich, which is really quite...
That's right.
Yeah, me too.
Guys are saying the same thing.
Right. Yeah, and the question is what happened is I remember part of that had to do with the weakening of labor unions at that time through various measures, also the sending of jobs overseas and so forth. Then but you're right, that seems to be the genesis. That time period seems to be the genesis. I didn't know that fact when I was writing the book, so I wasn't able to ask Carter his perspective on that. But I'm reasonably confident it's nothing he didn't want it to happen, no. But it did happen. It began to happen during his watch. And then, of course, it was exacerbated during the Reagan years rather dramatically. But it did start during his watch. But, you know, I mean, I'm just guessing, looking at this crowd, a lot of us lived through the late 70s, and economically, it was not a good time for anybody in this country. It was really difficult days for us. What did Jimmy Carter think of the book? I don't know. He hasn't told me. I'm kind of disappointed. I sent him one FedEx when it came out. But I haven't seen him since, so I don't know. I think he's. I don't know what he's. I think one of the reasons that there haven't been more biographies of Jimmy Carter is that he's written so much about himself. So I think he's kind of scared away a lot of biographers. And I just decided to kind of jump in because I wanted to tell a story about his faith and how his faith really did inform his life and has and continues to inform his life for that matter. And I don't know what he thinks of the book. It's a great question. I wish I knew. Maybe I'll find out. Maybe he'll let me know.
At least you could do send him a copy. He gave you a copy.
Yeah, he did.
Oh, I did. No, I did send him a copy. But he has. Yes, please.
His email.
Does he? I don't have his email address. No, I have his. No.
Too bad.
I have the email address of the people who get to him, but not him directly. No. Yes, please.
I've always wondered about, in terms of how the hostage crisis came about. The decision to let the Shah come here for medical,
yeah,
treatment, how did that come about? Was Kissinger involved?
Oh, yes.
That's what I assumed.
Yeah. The question was about, as some of you remember, that what precipitated or what at least lit the fuse for the Iranian Revolution was the medical treatment that the Shah was receiving here in the U.S. And Carter was reluctant to let that happen, but he was prevailed upon by David Rockefeller and Henry Kissinger to admit the Shah to the U.S. to get medical treatment, and that's what triggered the Iranian Revolution and the taking of the hostages in Iran. So, but Carter's never, I mean, to my knowledge, certainly not publicly, maybe privately, but he's never pointed the finger of blame or anything like that. He's taken full responsibility for that. You know, the other thing about the Iranian hostages is that some of you are probably aware of a book by Gary Sick called October Surprise. Very, very strong evidence. It cannot be conclusive because these records are not available to the public, but there's very, very strong evidence that the Reagan-Bush campaign cut a deal with the regime in Iran to hold the hostages until after the election. And in fact, as you remember, the hostages were released 15 minutes after Ronald Reagan was inaugurated as president. And the payoff was the Iran-Contra affair, right? Yes, please.
The nation wanted to disavow itself of the Nixon years, and that was probably really the Gerald Ford law. Carter was at the right place at the right time, kind of. Do you think he saw himself as a continuation of that healing process?
Of the what?
Of the healing process of the nation.
Healing process. I think he did. Yeah, I think Carter did see himself as... I wouldn't say messianic figure. He would never say that about himself. He's not that kind of person. But he saw himself as playing an important role in trying to heal the wounds of the nation. And remember what his first sentence in his inaugural address was, a tribute to Gerald Ford, which was really quite remarkable. He said, I'm going to paraphrase because I don't have it exactly, but I first want to acknowledge my predecessor for all he has done to heal our land. And it was really a remarkably gracious statement towards someone who had been his opponent in that election. But Carter very much saw himself as a healing figure. And I think he's absolutely right about that. Again, sometimes I do kind of think back to the Nixon years, and it's just, those 73, 74, it was just a dark, dark time in this country. And we're living in a time right now of such utter cynicism toward government. And I think, you can trace that all sorts of ways, but I think you have to go back to Vietnam, you've got to go back to Johnson, and particularly Nixon. And I think what Carter tried to do as president was to reverse that and to restore faith in government. But by that time, a sense of betrayal on the part of the American people had given rise to cynicism. And I think we've never pulled out of it. We're still cynical. We're profoundly cynical, not to mention partisan, but profoundly cynical about government. And I think it has to go back to those years. It's just not a happy time. Yes, please.
You mentioned that the evangelicals bailed on Carter.
Yeah.
Has he bailed on that?
Jimmy Carter. I asked him when he first knew that he was in political trouble with evangelicals, and he said he said two things at two different times when I asked him that. One was, he said he first was alerted to the fact that Falwell was against him because his sister, Ruth Carter Stapleton, said, "Did you know Jerry Falwell's up in Juneau, Alaska, saying all sorts of nasty things about you?" And Carter said, "Why?" I mean, he couldn't quite understand this. But when I asked him the question directly, he said he knew he was in trouble when the conservatives took over the Southern Baptist Convention in 1979. And that really was a turning point. Certainly for the convention itself, has been a huge turning point. And shortly thereafter, a group of these new Southern Baptist leaders come to the White House And they meet with Carter, and at the end of the meeting, Bailey Smith, one of the, no, he wasn't the president at the time, but he has been president of the Southern Baptist Convention. At the end of the meeting, Bailey Smith says to Carter, he says, Mr. President, a lot of us are praying that you will give up your religion of secular humanism. And Carter says, he went back to the White House, to the living quarters of the White House that night and asked Rosalynn, what's secular humanism? What that was. So his relationship with the Southern Baptist Convention, I sometimes describe as a dysfunctional marriage, because they go through periods of separation and threats of divorce, and then they try to reconcile. And I think they're probably finally at the divorce stage now, where they really don't see eye to eye. He's more affiliated with the Cooperative Baptist Fellowship than he is with the Southern Baptist Convention. As for evangelicals themselves, I think Carter still sees kinship with people like Jim Wallace and places like Messiah College, Eastern University, and so forth. But I don't think there's real extensive interaction between them, though.
Could you talk a little bit about his post-presidency?
Yeah. Sure. Okay.
And how effective, it looks like he is. It's certainly very inspirational. Yeah. And he certainly looks like he has been one of the best post-presidents we've ever had.
Yeah, I've been invited to comment on his post-presidency. My favorite quote about Jimmy Carter comes from James Laney, the former president of Emory University, who said about Jimmy Carter is the only person in history for whom the presidency was a stepping stone. And I think it captures him very, very nicely. Carter doesn't like that comment, by the way. He doesn't appreciate that. But I think it does capture very well. And I think, again, what I was trying to argue in part, both in the lecture and in the book, is that once he was freed from the constraints of placating constituencies and these days raising money, anybody runs for office has to raise bushels of money and so forth, once he was freed from that, then I think he has been liberated to be more of a prophetic voice in society. You know, he's gotten a lot of static for his views on Israel and Palestine and so forth. But, you know, he's kind of unabashed about that because, you know, what are you going to do to me, right? I have a stature. I'm a former president. I know something about the Middle East. And, you know, I'm going to continue to talk, to speak out on that issue. Issues of the environment. And by the way, many environmentalists consider Jimmy Carter the greatest environmental president ever in terms of the conservation of public lands and so forth. I think his health initiatives have just been extraordinary. If you look at the Carter Center website, and I invite you to do that, you'll see the extraordinary things that he's doing all over the world. So I think in many ways he has been a more successful ex-president than he has been president, and I think James Laney was right. He saw the presidency as a stepping stone, and he's really been quite remarkable. Okay, thank you all, thank you.